In this lecture, we are going to learn about DNA fingerprinting, genomics, human genome project, biotechnological applications for human health.
In today's life, biotechnology has focused upon getting desired changes we need into products and also in organisms. For this, scientists have been working genetically and on a molecular basis for getting the results. Scientists are trying their best to bring about changes in the genetic makeup of an organism to get the desired result. Various techniques such as tissue culture, gene transfer, transgenesis, cloning, DNA fingerprinting, recombinant DNA technology have made drastic changes. DNA fingerprinting. We all know that we are made up of genes, and genes have chromosomes in them which are responsible for determining whatever the characters we have. Chromosomes make up the DNA. Everyone have a different DNA. No two people have same type of DNA, even if they are twins. Due to this all factors, everyone has their unique characteristics, which is also known as fingerprint. And the technique which is developed to identify a person with the help of DNA restriction analysis is known as DNA profiling, or more popularly or famously known as DNA fingerprinting. DNA fingerprinting technique is generally made up of the process where nucleotide sequence is identified. We must all know that 99% of all the persons is same. Only tiny bit pieces of the nucleotides are different. These difference or unusual sequences are known as variable number of tandem repeats, or VNTRs. The length of VNTRs in every person is different, and there are some steps which are followed for DNA profiling or DNA fingerprinting, which involves steps such as, first, DNA isolation. It is the technique where DNA is obtained from any genetic material of a person or any organism, such as we can collect their blood, semen, hair root, tissue or sample or cell. Then second step is DNA amplification. It is the process where if the obtained quantity of the DNA which we took out from DNA isolation is small, then it is inserted into a machine called PCR, which performs polymerase chain reaction so that we can grab more copies of DNA for more and more effective results. Third step is DNA fragmentation. It is a process where a tiny bit of DNA sample is taken and is treated with restriction endonuclease, which will perform the function of cutting the DNA on several locations of DNA, and we can get many pieces of DNA having different lengths. And this technique is also known as restriction fragment length polymorphism, or RFLP, also called as restriction digestion. Fourth step is electrophoresis. It is the technique where DNA samples which we have are taken and they are loaded into agarose gel electrophoresis. Then a charge is applied whereby the negatively charged fragments move to positive pole as opposite poles attract to each other. Due to these movements, we can get formation of bands, sudden blotting. Then the bands which we obtain from electrophoresis technique are now blotted on nylon membrane or nitrocellulose paper. Then what happens is the single stranded DNA get embedded into the membrane of the nylon sheet we are blotting on. Then a technique called hybridization is done, whereby the bands are flooded with many single stranded radioactive DNA probe. They are single stranded, and because DNA have the capability or the ability to replicate, form double strand, it will get linked to the sample DNA. Then photography is done, not like normal photography. The photography here is done as, remember, the whatever the strands we have on the nylon membrane and they are embedded on the membrane itself, they are attached with, they remain in contact with X-ray film, and so that the band form when documented They give a photographic image due to the X-ray film so that we can document it and note down the results. This technique of DNA fingerprinting was mainly developed by Alex Jeffries, who was a British geneticist. He used VNTRs, or as genetic markers, and he developed a method to measure the length of the DNA fragments which we get in the repetitive sequence. In India, however, this technique was developed by Dr. Lalji Singh. In this technique, he obtained a DNA probe from Y chromosome of female banded crayed snake, and he obtained a unique segment from this chromosome, which is also known as banded crayed mini satellite, BKM DNA. First of all, DNA fingerprinting was only used for forensic medicine technique, but nowadays it has been used for many cases, such as paternal or maternal disputed cases, or for any insurance claims, or it is used for study of phylogeny. Agriculture science is also hugely benefited from this technique, and this technique is also used in genomics. Genomics and Human Genome Project. Let us know about what it is called. It is an important question in your syllabus. This term, this word, genome, it means that the collection of all genes which are present in a cell or a virus. We all are comprised of cells, even if we are haploid or diploid. Normally, prokaryotes have single chromosome and have only one set of genes, so they are haploid. But since we being eukaryotic organism, we have two sets of genes, and since we are diploid, this genome, it is total collection of number of genes which are present. We have two set of haploid chromosomes, so that's why we are diploid, and prokaryotes have one set of chromosomes, that's why they are haploid. The Human Genome Project was initiated in the year 1990, and this was done by US Department of Energy and National Institute of Health. This project came to be completed 13 years later in 2003. It was collective effort of all the nations of the world, and it was nearly 13 to 15 year plan which was done to map and find out 80,000 to 100,000 genes and to sequence them into 3 billion base pairs so that we can find relations between them. In many ways, HGP came to explore a new field in biology, which was known as genomics, which is nothing but study of genes. Genomics actually provides all the researchers with main information and knowledge about what is the biology of the gene, how is it working, what is its structure and function, also which gene controls it, gene evolution, or is there any mutation taking place in the past. The main aim, however, was to find out what are the detailed maps of human genome. This collection of the sequence of the human genome came to be known as blueprint of the human, like blueprint of whatever we are made up of. And one use of this blueprint came to be known that after studying our biology and our behaviors, we could easily identify the genetic diseases we suffer. And so knowing about these genomes will enable us to tackle these diseases better and to provide new therapies and cure for mankind. Addition to studying human genome, also number of model organisms including E. coli, Arabidopsis thaliana, Saccharomyces cerevisiae, Drosophila melanogaster, Senior hepatitis elegans, and Mus musculus etc. were also studied, and many relations between these organisms and humans were discovered. And so when we know about the relation between the organisms and humans, we can also get a better understanding of how human evolved. Biotechnological applications for human health. There were many branches now spread so that we can get into applications for human welfare. First being insulin. We all know that insulin is a hormone that performs the function of regulating the amount of glucose or sugar which is present in our blood. The cells which are known as islets of Langerhans. More blood glucose present in the blood triggers these cells and they start releasing necessary amount of insulin to balance the amount of sugar. Without any insulin, the glucose starts building up in the blood and cells do not get any energy source. So people who do not have the necessary amount of insulin suffer from a disease called diabetes mellitus. Then in the year 1921, two Canadian scientists known as Frederick G. Banting and Charles H. Best, they were successful in purifying insulin from a dog's pancreas. Since ancient times, insulin was extracted and purified from pancreas of cattle and pigs. Since the chemical structure of insulin in these animals was only little bit different from human insulin, therefore it matches the body physiology of the humans and is acceptable for human use. In 1980s, genetic engineering came into light and then E. coli was injected with insulin, human insulin producing gene. And then instead of depending upon animals, and it was possible to produce genetically engineered insulin in an ample amount of quantity which can be used for the whole mankind who suffer from diabetes mellitus. So that is the main use of genetic engineering. But what about our two guys, Frederick Banting and H. Best? They became keenly interested in diabetes and they studied the disease at university. He extracted insulin from islet cells. Another student with Banting, Charles West, injected these islet cell fluid in a patient and cured him for diabetes using insulin. And for this, Banting was honored by Nobel Prize. Why wouldn't he? Because he performed such a good experiment which is useful still now. Second, vaccine. Vaccine is basically antigenic preparation which is used to stimulate the production of antibodies and to induce or increase immunity level against several diseases. Have you ever thought why we take vaccines time to time since we are born? See, basically what happens, how the production of vaccine takes place. Production of vaccine, it involves growing an organism which consists of particular toxic in a nutrient medium. Then after the organism has developed or have grown, then they are modified and altered to give the toxoids which are no longer toxic to human consumption. Then these toxoids are injected into humans or any organisms which require the particular antigen for a disease. These toxoids then become antigens which trigger the immune system, and the immune system recognizes it and hence start producing antibodies to act against the genuine toxins which can affect the human body. The first vaccine was produced by Edward Jenner in 1796. It was just an attempt to provide protection against smallpox, but accidentally he discovered vaccine. He, once upon a time, he noticed that milkmaids who milk the cow and the cow who has small boils on. These milkmaids were the only one who had already contracted cowpox. They seemed to be resistant to smallpox. Edward Jenner noticed that the milkmaids who have encountered cowpox from the cows, they seem to be resistant to smallpox. Then he said that we can make this thing work as like this human reaction to an injection of cowpox virus can work for smallpox virus as well. Gene therapy. If we ask ourselves the question that is it possible to treat genetic diseases, because genetic diseases are caused due to mutations. We do not know exactly how can we cure genetic diseases because it is totally natural, but there are two types of gene therapy which we can do. First is somatic cell therapy, in which the somatic cells are modified to correct a genetic defect which we have. Second, germline cell therapy, in which germline cells are modified to correct the defects. This gene therapy, it focuses on modifying whatever the original genetic makeup is. We can delete or replace a defective gene in an organism, and we can introduce a desired gene which can lead to a normal life. And we are not far away from a time when we can cause genetic diseases such as diabetes or cancer by replacing the genes and introducing normal genes into the individual. Some of the examples where gene therapy can be done are tissue plasminogen activator or TPA, which can reverse or prevent blood clot, human growth hormone producer gene. This can treat pituitary dwarfism, which is caused. Tissue growth factor beta or TGFB. It can promote development of new blood vessels and epidermal growth, which is very useful in wound healing and burns. Human blood clotting factor 8, which can treat hemophilia. Human insulin or humulin, which can treat insulin-dependent diabetics. DNA ACE, which can treat cystic fibrosis. Bovine growth hormone, which can increase cattle and dairy yields. Recombinant vaccines for prophylaxis of human and animal viral diseases such as hepatitis B. Genetically engineered bacteria and other microorganisms are utilized for improved production of industrial enzymes on an industrial basis. Genetically engineered bacteria can also increase the degradation of oil pollutants or certain chemicals in toxic way. Transgenic animals. We all know that livestock animals, they form the major source of our food, milk or daily bread and butter. Now, naturally, there have been very much interest in improving the quality of livestock production. This can be done by gene transfer techniques and also clone gene into fertilized eggs. So in mere short period of time, we can obtain a progeny which has a very good quality meat or milk, large quantity milk, or can produce a large amount of progeny. So we can obtain transgenic animals nowadays due to genetic engineering. Then nowadays we get transgenic rats, rabbits, pigs, sheep, cows and fish as well. But moreover, 95% of the transgenic animals we obtain are mice. It is due to they have short generation time, and a super ovulated mouse can yield up to 40 eggs. Implantation if done, this single mouse can carry up to 20 offspring. So transgenic animals are very beneficial for man for scientific as well as commercial value. There are various other uses as well to genetic engineering or transgenic animals, which is first a study of diseases. We all know or have seen mice used in our laboratories for many experiments. Why? Because just I explained that they can reproduce or produce offspring in short amount of time. Many transgenic animals, they are designed to study how genes contribute in our development of diseases. With the help of these animals, we can study many diseases such as cancer, cystic fibrosis, rheumatoid arthritis, Alzheimer's, if we can do, as we cannot grab a human and perform experiment on it. Second is vaccine safety. The mice which we use, transgenic mice, they are used for testing safety of polio vaccine or various other vaccines. Transgenic animals would also be very useful as bioreactors, which can be important for producing proteins. And it was possible in 1997 when a transgenic cow, Rosie, it produced human protein-rich enriched milk, which was very nutritionally balanced milk than the natural cow milk.